Good evening, friends. I am very happy and it's my privilege to introduce Mr. N.Manikandan, Government Advocate, Madras High Court, who is none other than my colleague, who is going to give a lecture on Information Technology Act. I just want to tell about him first. He's a man of a simplicity and this dedicated person. In each and every cases, he prepares a detailed note before preparing for a case. Let's see how he's going to give a lecture on Information Technology Act.
First of all, let me thank my dear brother Dev Narendra for speaking about me. I welcome you all for this session to have an overview on the topic of Information Technology Act, and I thank the Madras Presidency Forum for having given me this opportunity. Before we going into see about an overview on the Information Technology Act 2000 is concerned, let me give the introduction on the development of on the history of cyber law. The first comprehensive international effort dealing with the criminal law problems of computer crime was initiated by Organization for Economic Cooperative Development in the year 1983. The founder members of the said organization were nearly about 20 countries. Some of them are Austria, Belgium, Canada, Denmark, West Germany, Ireland, Iceland, Italy, Switzerland, United Kingdoms, United States, and so on and so forth. The said organization forms ad hoc committees, and it tried to regulate the computer fraud or forgery and so on. The ad hoc committee so formed had two lists, one is minimum list and an optional list. The minimum list is to have control of the computer fraud, computer forgery, damage of computer data, or computer programs and computer sabotage, or unauthorized access or reproduction of protected computer program or reproduction of cryptography. The optional list contains the alteration of computer data or computer programs, unauthorized use of computer, unauthorized use of protected computer program. Though all the countries do form part of the said organization, India is still refraining itself from becoming its member in order to expand its sectoral engagement. But however, India is form of the sum of committee of the said organization, though it's not a member. The Information Technology Act 2000 came into force on 17th October 2000. This act led to the amendments in IPC, Bankers Book Evidence Act, Reserve Bank of India Act, the Evidence Act. Before going to this overview on the topic, though the said act came into force, but the appointment of the adjudicating officers were not appointed, and so a appeal was filed in the Bombay High Court in the year 2002. Only thereafter the directions were given to the central government for appointment of the said post. This should have been done. The appointment of the said post should have been done well in advance, so that the procedures could have been formulated and made out. The Information Technology Act, before we go into that, the Act consists of 13 chapters with 90 sections and 2 schedules. The preamble of the Information Technology Act clearly emphasizes on 3 factors. 1, electronic data interchange. Number 2, storage of information. Number 3, filing of electronic records with the government agencies. And further to amend the Indian Evidence Act, the Bankers Books Evidence Act, Reserve Bank of India Act, and the Evidence Act. The section 1.4 of the Information Technology Act says that Nothing in this act shall apply to documents or transactions specified in the first schedule. Let us see what is first schedule. The first schedule consists of five type of things. One, the Negotiable Instruments Act as defined under the Negotiable Instruments Act. Number two, the Power of Attorney as defined in the Powers of Attorney Act. Number three, a trust as defined in the Indian Trust Act. Number four, a will as defined in Section 2H of the Indian Succession Act. Number five, any contract for sale or conveyance of immovable property or any interest on such property. These things the Information Technology Act doesn't apply. The definition part of the Information Technology Act nearly contains 40 subsections, of which some of the few of which will be helpful for our discussion on this topic today is asymmetric crypto system, which means a system of a secure key pair consisting of a private key and a public key to verify the digital signature. Certifying authority, a person has defined in Section 24 of the Act. The other important definition will be intermediary. Who is intermediary? Normally, any person between two persons who transfers the information is the intermediary. As for the definition part of this act is concerned, it says intermediary with respect to any particular records means any person who on behalf of another person receives, stores or transmits that record or provides any service with respect to that record, and includes telecom service providers, network service providers, internet service providers, web hosting service providers, search engines, online payment sites, online e-auction sites, online marketplaces and cyber cafes. By this definition, the entire terminology, whatever may be, under the scope of the information intermediary is clearly defined under the Act. So these persons who does this job are termed to be as intermediary. The private key means a key used to create a digital signature, and the public key means a key of a key pair used to verify the digital signature. So these are the some definitions which I thought will be useful while going into session. The section 3 and section 3A clearly states about the digital signature and the electronic signature. As far as the digital signature is concerned, the system of asymmetric crypto system, which I discussed a few minutes back, is the system deployed or utilized for the purpose of digital signature. The legal recognition of electronic records is that where any law provides that information or any other matter shall be in writing or in the typewritten or printed form. The Information Technology Act is covered for that and it mandates how it has been done. The appropriate government for the purpose of this chapter and for efficiency of delivery of services to the public through electronic means authorized by order any service provider to set up, maintain and upgrade the computer facilities. The appropriate government may also authorize any service or authorized person to collect, retain and appropriate such service charges as may be prescribed by the appropriate government while providing of such services from the person availing such services. The electronic records has got to be maintained in for the purpose of at any future period. The appropriate government or the authority under the Act shall call on the person to provide the information that is required for them for the purpose of certain clarifications or certain for any investigation sort of thing is concerned. The retention of electronic records is really mandatory. Normally, when we have a system for a personal purpose, take for example, I have a company desktop for my personal purpose. The electronic records that has been stored on the hard disk is the data retained by me, either it may be ordered by me, that is created by me, or I would have take some contents from other sources, from the internet, or I would have scanned some textbook and kept for my reference. The retention of electronic record towards intermediary is very vital, because intermediary, as per the definition, they are the persons who provide the service for the effective utilization of the internet is concerned. So they are the intermediaries who hold the records at any, who must hold the records at any point of time for any purpose of interrogatives or any purpose of investigation on certain crimes, or for any other purpose the appropriate government or the controlling authority may require at that current point of time. The Act very specifically mandates that the electronic records has got to be kept in a safe and secure purpose, which may at any point of time be called upon to produce for the purpose I said previously. Though it may be that the electronic records has got to be retained or to be kept by the concerned persons or by the concerned service providers, it doesn't mean that any person can insist on the government to hold the record for a particular purpose. It means the document cannot be insisted upon the government to be held in a electronic record by any individual person. It's up to the government who can decide and hold on the topic of the retention of records is concerned. As now the government is for welfare of the state, it is also for the protection, it is also who gives the protection for the peaceful living of every individuals. So the more concern for the state is concerned is that the records which might harm the harmony of the state or the country is concerned, the intellectual agency is keep on monitoring on the transfer of transmission of data for interruption for the benefit of the public, in order to stop the damage at the initial stage itself. As far as the variety of contracts formed through electronic means is concerned, the contract formation, the communication of the proposals, the acceptance of proposals, the revocation of proposals and acceptance as the case may be, are expressed in electronic form or by any means of electronic records, such contract shall not be deemed to be unenforceable solely on the ground that such electronic form or means was used for that purpose. For this contention, let us have an idea of the Indian Contract Act, where there is offer, there is an acceptance, and only then the contract gets fulfilled. Merely because an offer is there and there is no acceptance, the contract doesn't hold on. So there must be an offer, there must be an acceptance, and the offer and acceptance, only when it has been done, it fulfills a contract. The decision of a Madras High Court rendered in Tamil Nadu Organic Private Limited and others of State Bank of India, AR 2014 Madras 103. In this case, the Honorable High Court has held that this is the case where the case was filed to quash the e-auction notice of sale of properties is concerned. Previously, when I was referring to section 1-4 of the Information Technologies Act, it is concerned, it referred to Schedule 1 of the Act. In the Schedule 1, in Schedule 1, it clearly states that any sale or transaction is not binding on the Information Technology Act is concerned. It categorically states that the Act doesn't apply to where there is a sale or transaction and so on and so forth. Here is the case where the court held that though it is an auction e-sale, that is an e-auction, the contents of Schedule 1 doesn't cover under this case, and held that the e-auction is confirmed thereon by the manual sale of raising the document is concerned. So the section has got to be properly applied while deciding on the case is concerned. And the other very important or the other relevant provision under the Information Technology Act is concerned is that the time and place of dispatch and receipt of electronic record. As otherwise agreed between the originator and the addressee, the dispatch of an electronic record occurs when it enters a computer resource outside the control of the originator. The time of receipt of an electronic record shall be determined when the addressee has designed a computer resource for the purpose of receiving the electronic record. Receipt occurs at the time when the electronic record enters the designated computer, and that is not the designated computer resource. The receipt occurs at the time when the electronic record is retrieved by the addressee. If the originator or the addressee has more than one place of business, the principal place of business shall be the place of business. The contents of this is that the time and place of dispatch of a receipt of an electronic record has properly decided. The classic example which I would refer for this topic is the contents of this which I referred is that the L&T Hydrocarbon Engineering Limited versus Oil and Natural Gas Corporation, which is reserved with Delhi High Court. This is where the case where a bid was called on by the L&T Hydrocarbon Engineering Limited. This is the bid called on by the Oil and Natural Gas Corporation, where the L&T Hydrocarbon applied for the bid. It said that the before going into the judgment aspect, citation aspect is concerned, let me give a brief outlook of the case law. Normally, when a bid is being called on, there will be two parts. One is technical bid and this is a commercial bid. When a person is technically qualified, only then the commercial bid will be decided on. If a person is not competent to qualify the technical bid, thereon he will be disqualified, and the person who is deciding on the matter need not go into the commercial bid. It's something that a person may be technically strong but not a commercially strong, or a person can be commercially strong but not technically strong. When both the conditions are being satisfied, the tender is given to the said person who has applied for it on the factors that governs for purpose of the said bid. Normally, the lowest bidder will be offered for any tender is concerned, provided he fulfills the technical bid as well as the commercial bid and satisfies the same. In this case, it was so that the bid was to be sent through an electronic record, and the bid has got to be received before such a date and such a time. It means that if the data to be submitted for the electronic for the sent bid is not so received on the side of the recipient is concerned before its scheduled time and date, the person is not qualified to participate in the bid. It's something like, for example, when I say that I have to receive the papers on or before 4th of May at 3:20 p.m. And if I don't receive that, it means if I received after 3:20 p.m., then the person is not competent to participate in the bid. So thereby he is technically disqualified. He is totally disqualified in participating in the bid, either for his technical or commercial is concerned. In this case, curiously, the L&T said that it has dispatched the relevant particulars data through the online media as stipulated by the ONGC. Though the ONGC called on the e-bid is concerned, it had more than several times as postponed the auction period for one reason or other. The L&T had sent the communication as stipulated by the terms and conditions of the bid, and thereon the when the data has been transmitted from L&T to ONGC, it means the data has been transferred physically by movement from ONGC to L&T. I'm sorry, from L&T to ONGC. Once on the ONGC receives the information from L&T, the option from the sent mode to saved mode will be crypted on the system of ONGC and L&T is concerned. The contention of L&T is that it had specifically dispatched the relevant details through the online media to the concerned persons, to the ONGC, well before the time stipulated under the e-auction rules. But however, L&T said, the ONGC said that it hasn't received any data from the L&T within the specific time limit. So the L&T made a contention that an expert on the field may be appointed to technically examine the whether the data has been retransmitted from the source of L&T to ONGC. There were two teams have been directed to verify the details on those two persons' system is concerned. On examination by the technical team on both the points, that is namely the L&T and the ONGC, the report revealed that the data has been transmitted by the L&T well before the time stipulated by the ONGC, and the firewall of the L&T revealed that there is a log, that is the time has been digitally punched for the transmission of data from ONGC, from L&T. And the court further held that it draws reference to General Section 27 of the General Clause Act and made that the data has been transmitted by the L&T and the ONGC ought to have received the said information, said content, and so L&T is competent to participate in the e-bid. This is simple like that. The punch-in punch-out, the concept of punch-in punch-out at the time of an employee entering in the office premises of the organization. When an employee enters in the premises of the employer, there will be a machine, something like a swipe card or thumb impression device that will be fixed on the entrance of the premises is concerned. Once the employee enters there, he either to swipe the card or show his thumb impression on the glass display of the thumb impression machine too, which will recognize the data and confirms the fact that the so-and-so person has entered the premises of the office at so-and-so time. And similarly, when they go out of the office, the same system has got to be followed, which confirms the fact that so-and-so person has left the organization at so-and-so point of time and date. these technical developments reduce the work of the employer to reduce the ambiguity among the issue is concerned that the person has arrived the office and left the office during a particular date within a particular hours, and he was there within the premises of the employer within the time in and time out of the set purpose, time in time out as stated in the set device. Next, let us see about the controller, who is the regulating authorities of the said act. The central government, by notification in the official gazette, appoint a controller of certifying authorities for the purpose of this act, and may also by the same or subsequent notification appoint such number of deputy controllers as it deems fit. The controller shall discharge his function under this act subject to general control and directions given by the central government. The function of the controller is that he has to exercise supervision over the activities of the certifying authorities, certifying public keys of the certifying authorities, laying down the standards to be maintained by the certifying authorities, specifying the qualification experience which the employees of the certifying authorities should possess. The certifying authorities shall also play a role that with the previous approval of the central government, by notification the official gazette, recognize any foreign certifying authority as certifying authority for purpose of this act. The license for the digital signature can be made by making an application by a person to the controller for a license of electronic signature certificate. Unless the applicant fulfills all such requirements with respect to the qualification, expertise, manpower, financial resources, and other infrastructure facilities which are necessary to issue, a license shall be granted and shall be valid for such period and not be transferable or heritable. For this purpose, a person has got to make an application in such form as prescribed by the central government with an application fee of ₹25,000, and all such documents as are relevant for purpose shall be accompanied with the same. As far as the renewal of license is concerned, it shall be so made not less than before 45 days of the expiry of the license by making such application form. The authority, namely the controller, on receipt of such application may grant or refuse the license after giving a reasonable opportunity of the said person if it is so going to reject the same. In many of our laws, there is a concept called principle of natural justice to be followed. A proper adherence to the other side must be done and justice should be done. The same scenario is also under this act. And the authority can suspend its license when it comes to the knowledge of the controlling authority that the statement made in the application or in the elements of the license is incorrect or false, or it failed to comply certain terms and conditions, or it failed to maintain the standards under the act. It is so that no license shall be suspended for a period not exceeding 10 days unless certifying authority has been given a reasonable opportunity for showing cause against the proposed suspension person. The notice of suspension shall be displayed on the online. The controller may in writing authorize the deputy controller or assistant controller or any other person as the case may be, delegate his powers under this chapter. The controlling authority or any officer authorized by him for and purpose of this act and coming to know shall take up the investigation of any contravention of the provisions of the act and the rules made thereunder. When such investigation is so done by said person, he is like the person who is conferred the powers under Chapter 13 of the Income Tax Act. As far as the access to computer data is concerned, the authority or any person authorized under him shall have a reasonable cause to suspect shall have access to any computer or any apparatus or data or any other material contented with such system for purpose of searching or causing a search to be made. Section 69 is the power to issue directions for interception of or monitoring or decryption of any information through any computer resource. The license that has been granted has got to be displayed in a conscious space of the premises. As far as the surrender of license is concerned, the certifying authority whose license is suspended or revoked shall immediately after suspension shall surrender the same to the controller. If it is not so done, he shall be punished with imprisonment which may extend to 6 months or which may extend to fine of ₹10,000 or both. As far as the electronic signature certificate is concerned, any person may make an application to certifying authority to issue electronic signature certificate in such form as may be prescribed by central government by a fee accompanied of ₹25,000 with all the relevant particulars. And similarly, as far as suspension, the same which I said previously do form part of this same. The suspension shall not exceed 15 days unless the subscriber is given an opportunity of being heard. The penalties and compensation under the Act is clearly stated under Chapter 9 of the Information Technology Act is concerned. The penalty and compensation for damage to computer system is clearly stated under Section 43 of the Information Technology Act, which is only a civil remedy. As far as the punishment is concerned, is governed under Section 66 of the Information Technology Act is concerned. The key thing to be noted here is that any person without permission of the owner or any other person who is in charge of a computer or computer system or computer network access or secures access to such computer or computer system, downloads or make copies without the permission, and introduce a virus into the system or damage the system, or denies access to access the system, or charges the service availed of by a person to the account of another person by tampering with or manipulating any computer or computer system, he shall be liable to damage by way of compensation to the person so affected. Compensation for failure to protect data is that when a body corporate fails to protect the data, the corporate sector has got to pay liable to pay damages to or compensation to the person so affected. And the penalty for every person who is covered under the Act has to furnish any document or report to the controlling authority or the certifying authority. When he fails to furnish the same, he shall be liable to pay a penalty not exceeding ₹1,40,000 for each such failure. Friends, the Act very clearly says for each such failure. So we should be very cautious when handling these type of matters with our clients. And if a person fails to furnish any information or books or the documents, he shall be liable to fine of ₹25,000 every day. It's very every day. And a failure to maintain the records also carries the very same fine of ₹10,000 for every day. If anything not stipulated in the Act, any punishment or compensation is not stipulated in the Act for said act or event, the Act empowers under Section 45 to impose a fine of rupees not more than 25,000. As far as the power to adjudicate is concerned, normally the principal secretary of the government shall be the adjudicating officer. Whenever a person wants to lodge a complaint under the Act, it shall be so made before the adjudicating authority to whom the complaints has got to be made. And generally the principal secretary of the government shall be the adjudicating officers of the state is concerned. The adjudicating authority shall be given after giving the person referred to section 1 of section 46 a reasonable opportunity for making representation in the matter in so far, and on such a inquiry satisfied may pass in such an order. The adjudicating authority shall have the powers as that of a cyber appellate tribunal. The factors to be taken into account while deciding by the adjudicating officer is that a fair and reasonable opportunity should be given on both sides, and it should be the amount for damage should be quantifiable, and it has got to be done in a proper manner. Against the order of the adjudicating officer is concerned, the cyber appellate tribunal, a person has to approach a cyber appellate tribunal. Normally, the Telecom Dispute Settlement and Appellate Tribunal established under Section 14 of the Telecom Regulatory Authority of India shall on and from the commencement of Part 14 and Chapter 6 of the Finance Act 2017. The Appellate Tribunal for the purpose of this Act and the said Appellate Tribunal shall exercise the jurisdiction, powers and authority conferred on this Act. When there is a difference of opinion between two members of the appellate tribunal, it's being referred to the chairman who shall hear and decide on the matter. The orders of the appellate tribunal shall not be called on in question any manner and before any forum on the ground that merely on the ground that the defect in the constitution of the cyber appellate tribunal. No appeal shall lie to the cyber appellate tribunal from an order by an adjudicating officer with the consent of the parties. The appeal shall be made within 45 days from the receipt, within 45 days from the date on which a copy of the order made by the controller or the adjudicating officer is received by the person aggrieved. And the appeal shall be disposed within six months from the receipt of the appeal. The powers of the cyber appellate tribunal is as similar to the as stated in the CPC, summoning and enforcing utterance of any person, receiving evidence on affidavits, requiring the discovery or production of any documents, issuing commission and so on and so forth. The any person can authorize a legal representative to appear and put forth his contention on behalf of the said person, which is a right given under the Act. As far as the limitation aspect is concerned, the Limitation Act is applied to an appeal under the Cyber Appellate Tribunal. The civil court is totally barred under the Act, and no compensation of whatsoever manner in the arising out of the information, the scope of Information Technology Act is concerned, the civil court is totally barred. And from the order of the Cyber Appellate Tribunal, a person aggrieved so shall make shall file an appeal before the High Court within 60 days from the date of communication of the decision of the order of the Cyber Appellate Tribunal. The Delhi High Court, in one of the cases decided in State Bank of India versus Chandra Kalani and others, it is a case where the respondent held 6 fixed deposits in the State Bank and 2 is an NRI. The bank received a call from one of the unknown person claiming to be the respondent, has called on to divide the deposits and transfer the same. The official of the said bank, without confirming the fact that this said person is the respondent, and revealed all the vital information to the bank, and the funds was transferred without the knowledge of the respondent. The respondent, when approached the bank for some other purpose to verify his entries, he by then he came to know that the fixed deposits in his account has been withdrawn from the account of him by an unknown person. Thereon, the said person lodged a complaint before the principal secretary IT government of Maharashtra, and the adjudicating officer directed the bank to pay a sum of Rs 40 lakhs along with the interest rate of Rs, rate of 12% per annum. Challenging the same, the bank filed the appeal before the High Court in Delhi. The friends, the thing that should be borne in mind is that the judicial aspect has got to be clearly understood where an appeal has got to be filed. Here in the case is that the principal secretary is the government of Maharashtra, whereas the appeal has been filed before Delhi High Court. The Delhi High Court said that you have to approach the concerned jurisdictional court, which is the Bombay High Court, and they said the issue has got to be decided there. As far as the recovery of penalty is concerned, if the persons to whom the fine is imposed, and if he doesn't fail to, and if he fails to pay, the recovery shall be made as that of an arrear of land revenue, and the license as the case be shall be suspended till the penalty is paid. Friends, as of now, we have seen the compensation, which is a civil remedy, more or less a civil remedy to the persons is concerned. And as far as the chapter 11, which is the penal provision under the Act, it nearly starts from section 65 onwards and it goes till 78. There are various type of offences, and the remedies there under the punishment is given under section from 65 to 78. It so covers that tampering with computer source data, punishment for sending offensive message through communication services, punishment for dishonestly receiving stolen computer resources, punishment of identity theft, punishment for defeating the personalization by using computer resource, punishment for violation of privacy, punishment for cyber terrorism, punishment for publishing or transmitting obscene material in electronic form. Friends, the section 67 is very crucial in nowadays. And punishment for publishing, transmitting material containing sexually explicit material. This is also very important thing to be looked into. And punishment for publishing or transmitting of material depicting children in sexually explicit material in erotic form. Friends, section 67, 68A and 67B. We are facing every now and then these type of offences being committed by the persons on the internet. Friends, though the government is trying to ban the offensive sites and blocking these sites, still then some of the sites are being viewed by many of the viewers who are addicted. Let me give an example, my brother, on this topic is concerned. This I have read in an article a few months back. This is where it happened in North India. A couple who had got newly married. After marriage, the wife went for father's home, and the husband was alone at home, and he was viewing the prohibited sites on his television, which had the Android device. The television which is being viewed and is mostly on the Android television sets. Though technically the television set is a very advantageous for the mankind is concerned, it depends upon the person who uses it. This man was viewing the pornographic sites on his television set for on several occasions. The wife who went to her father's place came back. The family went on, and after that, once again, she left her in-law space for some purpose. Thereupon, the gentleman was also viewing the pornography sites. While so, he was viewing it. Surprisingly, he was able to see his own bedroom on the site. He was so surprised to see that his bedroom is able to be seen on the website, and he doesn't know how it was captured. He called on the persons technically on the software site to view what is going wrong in the television set or any spy cameras that is being kept in his bedroom. The persons who deployed could not able to trace out what exactly the thing is watched, because the person didn't reveal that he was viewing the pornography sites on his Android TV. After several verifications, and the persons cannot trace out what exactly how the bedroom was viewed. And after discussion with the person, the experts in the field came to know that he was viewing the pornography sites on the Android mobile, Android television set. That struck the experts to examine the inner parts of the software of the Android TV. That they came to know that some fishy software has been installed, and through that the video of his bedroom could be viewed. Friends, please bear in mind that the development of information technology has reduced our task to a major extent. Simultaneously, there is many disadvantages too, which we should be very careful in while handling the internet is concerned. And another classic example which I could give is that the telephony call which we would often receiving, that so and so calling from so and so bank, and we want to verify your credentials on some sort of nonsense they would be speaking. Friends, please be aware, when we receive a telephonic call claiming to be a person from so and so bank, please avoid those calls, and please visit your nearest branches and make the what are the informations you want to confirm or you want to get clarified. Please go near your branch bank is concerned, and please do that. And don't allow any unwanted telephonic calls claiming to be a person from so and so bank. This is so happens, my friends. The person who claims himself an official of a bank will confirm the fact that that you are so and so by calling your name. He will also confirm is your date of birth to confirm the fact that he is the person really speaking from the bank, and he will also confirm the fact he will call upon you to give your proof of address which you have furnished the bank. This is the fact to confirm more, to create more confidence on the person that he is an official of the said bank. We also think that he is the person speaking from the bank, knowing the fact that he revealed the date of birth of ours and also the real name which we have given to the bank. Once we give the particulars of the proof of address, then he will pose so many questions here and suddenly he will collect the information of the debit card along with the CVV number. Once that information is being furnished by us, the amount lying in our bank will immediately be scooped away from the account of ours and the balance will be nil. This is happening day in, day out. Though the information system towards the computerization of banking sectors and the other things is concerned is developed, still there are many hackers or persons who cheat us and without knowing us that we are being cheated, take and they collect all the money lying in our account. And as far as section 67 is concerned, the punishment is very severe, and it goes up to 3 years, and for the first time offense it a fine not exceeding rupees 5 lakhs, and for subsequent second time conviction, the may extend to 5 years or a fine with rupees 10 lakhs. As far as the 67A is concerned, there is transmitting sexually explicit materials. If the person will be punished with imprisonment for not exceeding 5 years or a fine not exceeding 10 lakhs. And if a second time it is conviction for not exceeding 7 years or is fined rupees 10 lakhs. As far as the child is concerned, section 67B enumerates that the conviction can be extended to 5 years or fine not exceeding rupees 10 lakhs, and subsequent event it is imprisonment of 7 years or more or fine exceeding not exceeding rupees 10 lakhs. And all the punishments under the offence under the stated under chapter 11 has got to be clearly bear in mind when we advise our clients. The penalty under this act, one other thing I forgot to say. In Shreya Singhal versus Union of India, decided by the Supreme Honorable Supreme Court, it said that it struck down section 66A of the act is concerned. That is an offense punishment for sending offensive message through communication, and it said that the fundamental right under section 19 is curtailed, and so it has struck down the section 66A of the act is concerned. As the penalty for misrepresentation is concerned, it will be imprisonment not exceeding 2 years or fine rupees 1 lakh. Friends, let me refer to the decision rendered by Kerala High Court in Johnson, Gilbert and others versus the sub-collector secretary in Nehru Trophy Road Society and others. This is a case where the person claimed to be the appellant herein was running a boathouse in Kerala, and he was earning his livelihood. The near to his place where the Nehru Trophy boat race was being conducted, and the said society was collecting fees for viewing it. The Johnson Gilbert, who was running the boathouse, he also opened a website and said that you can some sort of decorative works, and you can enjoy the pleasant stay on watching the boat race more. He also collected fees for the boathouse clubbed with the viewing boat race. The boathouse will go near the launch, will go near the place of the race course, race place area, and launch the boathouse there. And the persons who engage the boathouse can view the boat race sitting on the boathouse. The society charged the person who is viewing the boat race, and the Sir Johnson also paid the same. Something went wrong. The offence was the said person was charged under section 71 of the act, saying that he is misrepresented and got license to hold the website. The contention of the on the side of the Johnson was that they have paid the fees, necessary fees. They have not suppressed the fact. And everything was properly done by them. The court held that there is no rhyme or reason why it has been the said person has been charged with section 71, and it has caused the said proceedings under the act. Friends, the penal provision is very exhaustive one, and we have to be very careful while dealing with the matters of when we advise our clients. And one other classic example I would say is that the decided by the Allahabad High Court in 2018, which is a case between Amit Kumar Jadhav versus State of UP. In the case, the person, this report was filed by the team of supply department, wherein that the person has collected all the things from the food grains, etc., from the public distribution system using Aadhaar card and faking it. Friends, these things are being commonly happening here, and it is the though the authorities try to regulate by rules and regulations, still then the persons hack those rules and regulations and get along with the matters is concerned. And the Act enumerates various provisions for the offences is concerned, and we should be very careful in dealing all these matters. And the friends, I forgot to say one good decision as far as the intermediary is concerned. It is the case between Swami Ramdev versus Facebook and others, which has decided Delhi High Court in 2019. This is the case where the Swami Ramdev has name has been defamed by publication in the website, and though as want of time, let me concise the issue is concerned. The role of the intermediary is concerned, they are protected under section 79 of the Act, and they are only intermediaries. But the what they say is that in this case, what they say is that we are only intermediary and we are not the authors of the content, and that persons who have been authors has not been shown as a party to the proceedings is concerned, and because of non-joinder it has got to be decided. There was a contention of the respondents. The court viewed the matter that the defaming a person is not correct, and contention of the side of the Swami Ramdev was that the sites has got to be blocked in, and an interim order was passed to block the websites. Thereafter, it said that the court called on the contention on the side of the Swami Ramdev was that it has got to be blocked not only within India but also through global. There is a question whether the court has competent to pass an order blocking the websites outside the jurisdiction of India. This is a very peculiar aspect that has got to be decided. The Facebook and the other respondents therein kind of made a contention that blocking the site in India is possible, but blocking outside the India is not within their hands. But as these are intermediaries who play the role, they are the persons who are competent to block the global website as far as the case is concerned. That was decided by the Railway Court. The various decisions has been decided on the matter while deciding on this case. One of the classic examples that was decided in the that was discussed in this case is that the Canada court passed a judgment where to block the websites outside Canada also. Based on that judgment, the person, the beneficiary of the judgment, intervened on the when the site was hosted in US. The beneficiary of the judgment brought to the knowledge of the court that the order is valid in US also, and so the site has got to be blocked. The authorities then revealed that the act doesn't approve, the act of the United States doesn't bar on the blocking of websites is concerned. So when that be the case, the US people say that we can't block the website on the that country. And several similar sort of discussions were held in the Swami Ramdev case, and finally the court held that to block the websites globally and see that the defendant platforms upon receiving notice of the plaintiffs or upon opinion for material content is not defamatory or violative, they shall intimate the plaintiffs and the plaintiffs would seek remedies in accordance with law. Friends, here one thing I want to say. Here one of the respondents is also a YouTube channel. The YouTube channel said that when a video is being uploaded in that site and they upload the YouTube channel, the YouTube has a right to delete the video without the permission of the uploader on committee know of the fact that it is explicit of any offensive one under the act. Friends, please bear in mind when you upload any videograph or photograph which is violative in nature, you can be punished under the act, under the Information Technology Act. So please bear in mind when dealing with the weapon of internet, which may defend you as well as it may go against you when you handle in a wrong manner, which is violative in nature against the rules and regulations. As far as the Evidence Act is concerned, my friends, the primary data that is there in the system is the primary data, and the section 65B of the Evidence Act clearly defines the what is how the electronic data can be produced as an evidence before the court of trial. The manners that has been clearly stated in section 65B of the Evidence Act is concerned, that is, you got to get a certification from the person competent to give, stating that the information has been taken out from the so and so computer system and it has been in a proper working condition, so on and so forth. The Act, section 65B of the Evidence Act, clearly enumerates the procedures to be adopted while complying and producing an electronic record as a piece of evidence before the court. The Act is very clear, and I come to the conclusion of the session is concerned. There are so many apps that has been developed and which are being used by us in our Android mobile phones. Friends, have you ever looked on before installing an app, the contents that is being displayed? Once the app is being, once we try to install an app, it will call on the information whether permission is required to access the contacts, media, and the photos. Media includes video and photos. And there are some apps which also call on that certain particulars will be taken from your device for experimenting themselves in the, for their marketing purposes. Friends, when we install the app, we just blindly give the option of yes, yes, and proceed on for installing the app for the usage of the said app by yes, without looking into those contents. Friends, please bear in mind, the personal data, which are the data of us, should not be revealed to anyone at any point of time without our consent. Because some informations may go against us, and some informations may result us in a heavy loss to us, which are the personal informations to us. And we also know that the photos are getting morphed by the software, and adult sites are being posted, and the photos are being posted in adult sites. Recently, our Madras High Court also decided on the issue of TikTok, which we have known to delete certain contents in the TikTok videos. disclosure of explicit of sexual of sexual details or sexual images are to be banned in a heavy manner. And friends, please bear in mind, though the internet is a fortune for us, it should be properly utilized in a proper manner, and it has got to be used only for the purpose it has been so developed by the developers. Friends, please bear in mind that when you use an internet, keep bear in mind that a sword is hanging over your head, and when you utilize for an offensive purpose, the sword which is hanging on your head may fall at any point of time. I mean, the law and regulations of the country is concerned. And though the punishments under the chapter 11 of the act is concerned is very clear and categorically stated that imprisonment and fine and all. As far as the fine is concerned, regarding the nature of offense is concerned, it has got to be enhanced. That is my personal view. Unless a heavy penalty is imposed, the person who does the offense or the person who is going to do subsequent offenses will avoid those, try to use those things, whereby we could have a clean society at large. I thank all the participants here for patiently viewing my session on the topic of Information Technology Act is concerned, and I thank Madras President's Lawyers Forum for giving me this wonderful opportunity to share my knowledge on the topic of Information Technology ISI. And one thing I want to say, though I have not covered the entire sections in detail, I could do it in another session on being on opportunities granted. Thank you, one and all. Thank you.
I deem it a great honor and privilege to propose the vote of thanks on this memorable occasion and making the session very interesting and interactive. I thank all the distinguished invitees present here for accepting our invitation. Last but not least, I thank you all, my friends, for your cooperation in making this meeting, this webinar a resounding success. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.